My topic was given only Volkmann systemic contracture, but before I start discussing on that thing, all of you should have a thorough idea of compartment syndrome. I don't know whether the class has been taken before or not regarding compartment syndrome, but without understanding compartment syndrome, you cannot understand Volkmann systemic contracture. This is not separate thing. Volkmann systemic contracture is the untreated, or you can say the end point of an untreated compartment syndrome. If a compartment syndrome happens and if it is left untreated for many hours and days in upper limb, it will eventually lead in Volkmann's systemic contracture. Now, what is compartment syndrome? Compartment syndrome is characterized by six P's. Every time I keep on repeating that thing. That is pain out of proportion, pallor, paresthesia, poikilothermia. That means the temperature of that limb will go down than the room temperature. Then there will be pressure. Another P is pressure, increased pressure in the compartment. It will eventually lead to this contracture if you don't release the pressure. If it is left untreated, the ischemic changes will come and eventually leading to contracture. Okay, let's move on. Now, that is a definition, because Volkmann systemic contracture was first described for the upper limb and the forearm. But ischemic contracture can occur anywhere. It can occur in legs, or it can occur in foot. Whenever there is compartment syndrome in the leg or in the foot or in the thigh, if it is left untreated, it may lead to contracture. But the Volkmann's described this condition first time in upper limb in case of supracondylar fracture. That's why Volkmann systemic contracture is specific for your forearm contractures because of compartment syndrome. So a condition which is characterized by ischemic necrosis of the structures contained within the volar compartment of the forearm, associated with crippling contractures and varying degrees of neurological deficit. Okay, so always remember, Volkmann systemic contracture is for forearm, whereas ischemic contracture can occur anywhere. It can occur in thigh, leg, foot, anywhere. Now, Volkmann stated that paralytic contractures that develop within a few hours after injury are caused by arterial insufficiency or ischemia of muscles. He just proposed a theory, but there are later on people came with many other things which also play in part. It is not only the arterial insufficiency. See what happens, once there is an occlusion to that arterial circulation, it itself doesn't lead to that ischemic contractures. There is ischemia, and ischemia will lead to tissue necrosis. And once there is tissue necrosis, the cell will die, the muscles will start dying. And once there the cells dies, the muscle dies, there will be release of lysosomal enzymes, as well as there will be release of many cytokines, which will eventually lead to an inflammatory response in that area, which also exacerbates that compartment syndrome, increases the pressure in the compartment. Any inflammation will lead to exudation, edema, and it will further increase the compartment syndrome. So not only arterial insufficiency which leads to contracture, arterial insufficiency, then tissue necrosis, then there will be an inflammatory response. All together it exacerbates that compartment pressure, eventually leading in compartment syndrome and left untreated Volkmann's ischemic contracture. Now, this is a good point. Volkmann's ischemic contracture, he said that could be caused by pressure from within or from without or both. Volkmann's ischemic contracture is a late sequelae of untreated or inadequately treated compartment syndrome, in which necrotic muscle and nerve tissue are replaced with fibrous tissue. Okay, this I have already told you, that ischemia follows by necrosis, follows by inflammatory response, increase in the compartment pressure left untreated, Volkmann's ischemic contracture. I'm repeating the same thing. Now, just look at the anatomy. I hope you can make out which one is the medial side and which one is the lateral side. Now, before you start understanding Volkmann's ischemic contracture, you should have a thorough idea regarding the volar compartment of the forearm. There are two volar compartments, one is superficial and one is deep. Now, all the flexor muscles, they have a common origin, which is medial epicondyle. You can see it. And another thing you should come to understand, what is lacertus fibrosus? There is one thing you can see in the monitor, that is bicipital aponeurosis, which is extending and coming medially, beneath which you can see the median nerve, radial artery. So that white fibrous thing is known as lacertus fibrosus, or it is extension of your bicipital aponeurosis. So this thing you should understand, first lacertus fibrosus, then there is a common flexor origin from where all the superficial compartment flexor muscles originates, your pronator teres, then flexor digitorum superficialis, then flexor pollicis longus, so many are there, six are there total. Then in the deep, there are three, flexor digitorum profundus, pronator quadratus. Now anatomy, okay, all these things are not important. You just remember that there is common flexor origin arising from the medial epicondyle, then lacertus fibrosus, and beneath lacertus fibrosus, there is your ulnar artery, radial artery, and median nerve. You keep in your mind, we will come to that point later. It will help you understand. Now, the median nerve accompanies the brachial artery beneath the lacertus fibrosus and enters the substance of the pronator teres, passing between its humeral and ulnar heads. Just have an idea of all these things. It will help you understand the pathology later on. So I'm just going through anatomy a little bit. Everything is there in the medially. In that area, people might think that, sir, how come the radial artery is also that side? So it is actually that your brachial, which goes and separates into lateral. Here it is clearly visible. In that elbow region, all the neurovascular structures are in the medial side. As it goes distal, it terminates into radial and ulnar. So now, what are the compartments of the forearm? Superficial volar compartment, deep volar compartment. These are in the volar aspect, and the other two are not so significant when we talk about the pathology of VIC. Because in VIC, always the volar compartments are involved. Always remember that dorsal compartments are involved, but not usually. The contracture that we see in VIC is because of ischemic necrosis of the muscles of the volar compartment. Two volar compartments, superficial volar and deep volar. In superficial volar, six muscles are there. In deep volar, three muscles are there. Now, etiology. Actually, the Volkmann's ischemic contracture, you open any textbook, I don't think you will get a separate chapter of VIC. VIC is always known as a complication of supracondylar fracture. It is always discussed under the heading of supracondylar fracture. So the most common cause of VIC is supracondylar fracture. We don't see VIC these days because of availability of orthopedicians even in the district hospitals, and people are now bit aware, parents are now bit aware. Even nowadays there is a trend of going to the local quacks and all, but still when the situation goes out of hand, people are not that stupid. Eventually they will come after one day, and most of the times we can salvage the limb. So supracondylar fracture of the humerus in children is the most common precipitating injury. The brachial artery may get impinged on the sharp proximal fragment against which it is held by lacertus fibrosus. Now, the little about the pathology. So you can see that proximal fragment is displaced anteriorly and the distal fragment is going posteriorly. So the humerus will impinge on that brachial artery, and we know whenever there is a fracture, there is hematoma. So all these will cause a mechanical compression to the brachial artery. And if it is left untreated or if it is not reduced properly, if the mechanical pressure of the brachial artery is not relieved, and on top of that, if the patient goes to quack, where he applies tight bandaging over the fracture, what is the ultimate solution, ultimate thing that will happen? The first thing that will happen is diminished perfusion of the forearm. And then compartment syndrome will set in. And if it is left untreated, say for 24 hours, the ischemic changes will become prominent and your ischemic necrosis will start and later in Volkmann's ischemic contracture. These are etiology. You can just go through it. Is of compartment syndrome etiology only. Now, what are the other causes? Any crush injuries, prolonged external compression, internal bleeding, burns, snake bites, and intravenous regional anesthesia. These are very, these are you can say unusual causes or uncommon causes. The most common cause, as I have told, is supracondylar fracture. Then your this crush injuries, external compression, this and that. Now this particular slide is very important for you. Always remember that the ischemic, how does the tissue reacts to ischemia? In muscle, functional impairment starts after 2 to 4 hours of ischemia, but that is not irreversible. That is reversible. You release the external compression, you reduce the fracture. Artery will the tissue muscle will reperfuse and the muscle will become normal again, but irreversible functional loss after 4 to 12 hours. Now the nerves, functional impairment after 30 minutes of ischemia and irreversible function loss after 12 to 14 hours. So now you might think that, sir, why irreversible functional loss in muscle is 4 to 12 hours? Why so much of window is there? Means there is, you can see there is a window of 8 hours between 4 and 12, because that is not always specific for every individual, and it depends on the underlying trauma and underlying cause also. If there is a complete transection of the brachial artery with that fracture, then it might settle in irreversible functional loss within 4 hours. But if there is some flow and proximally, not that much, but distally external compression is there, then it might take 12 hours. But always keep in mind that the upper limit of irreversible functional loss for muscle is 12 hours, and the upper limit for irreversible functional loss for nerves is 24 hours. So you have to intervene in such patients within 12 hours. And the best way to check the limb perfusion in a patient is what? Any idea? Patient coming with supracondylar fracture, how will you check for how will you check for perfusion, whether his limbs are perfused or not? What is the easy way? No reply as expected. You can check with a pulse oximeter, or you can check with clinically this capillary refilling. You press the tip of that your finger, and there will be a blanching followed by reversible of that blanching. So you take out that time. So one is checking the capillary filling time, and one is checking with a pulse oximeter. Pulse oximeter you might not get, and it might not give you the accurate diagnosis. So the most handy and the most useful in clinical practice is always to check the capillary filling time. Now, clinical picture, okay, acute compartment syndrome, I have told already, first there will be acute compartment syndrome. So, you have to diagnose that acute compartment syndrome. There will be pain out of proportion. And then all 6 Ps, you always remember the 6 Ps and good capillary filling and all I have just now told. Pain, pallor, paresthesia, pulselessness. There is another P missing, which is pressure. And pain out of proportion, paresthesia, pulselessness, pallor, paresis. Paresthesia, paresis almost near. There is another term missing, which is pressure and poikilothermia. Now, 2-point discrimination, these things you know, you have already read in medicine. Now, measurement of intracompartmental pressure, that is not available in all institute. I have not seen in my practice this instrument so far. In a working condition, obviously we were given during our post-graduation exams, but those were not in working conditions. These are mainly used in Western countries. You put that probe in a particular compartment and it will give you an reading of that compartment. Now, what is the use of that thing? Because you have just now come across a term known as impending compartment syndrome. Now, impending compartment is very easy to say, but it is very difficult to diagnose. So with that thing, you can diagnose that impending compartment. So it is important for you from MCQ point of view. Just remember that term, weak catheter and slit catheter. These are all important from your theory point of view. If you are really using that instrument, you should be thorough with these parameters. So range between 10 to 20 millimeter mercury below the diastolic pressure, cessation of blood flow is imminent. Then 40 to 50 mmHg muscle threatening compression and ischemia present, pressure of 30 millimeter mercury or greater, criterion for fasciotomy. So once the pressure you see it is more than the 40 to 50, that means already ischemia has been set in. And once the ischemia has already set in and it has crossed that critical time period, fasciotomy will not give you any benefit. So some consultants, they say better avoid fasciotomy. Once you sure that that critical time period of intervention has been over, ischemia has been already set, now some consultant, they avoid doing fasciotomy, because fasciotomy will have very little effect. Because even if you do fasciotomy and even some perfusion comes, that ischemia may not be reversed. Furthermore, there is another side effect. Once a ischemic or grossly necrosed tissue become reperfused, there is also chance of reperfusion injury, which is also a dangerous thing. You just Google it, the term known as reperfusion injury. Now, deformities in Volkmann ischemic contracture. I have already told you in Volkmann ischemic contracture, the two most common muscle groups involved are the superficial and deep of volar compartment. So, deep flexors are partially involved, particularly flexor digitorum profundus. And pronator quadratus is not that much involved, most commonly flexor digitorum profundus. And flexion contractures of one or more fingers which can be extended or hyperflexing the wrist. So it is a common sense, whenever there is increased compartment or increased pressure from inside, the most deep muscle group will be involved first. And if the pressure keeps on rising, because the pressure has been creating from inside, so the superficial muscle groups will be involved later. So this deformity you will be seeing later. Flexion contracture of one or more fingers which can be extended on hyperflexing the wrist. Now deformities of Volkmann's contracture. This is the mild type. There are sometimes in mild type there will be only flexion contractures of one or more fingers which can be extended on hyperflexing the wrist. And in moderate type involves most of the flexor digitorum profundus, flexor pollicis longus and part of flexor digitorum superficialis. So in moderate type the pressure is increasing, so the deep as well as the superficial muscle groups are also being involved. Now in severe type, this is the classic clinical picture. All the flexor muscles of both the superficial and deep group are involved. Neurological deficit is severe. And at this stage you will see joint contracture and wasting of forearm muscles. Now management of one more thing I want to tell you, this mild type you will see after that critical time period, that is around that 4 to 12 hours. Now, from this mild type to go to this severe type, it will take days, because fibrous changes will not come immediately. It will take few days time. So this is the acute presentation, and after why not after the say 24 hour you might see this thing, but acute this joint contractures and all, it will take few days time to reach this stage. Now, management of acute compartment syndrome. Now, it is written that impending VIC, but is don't use that term impending VIC. There is no such terms like that, impending VIC. For your better understanding, I have put it there, but there are no such terms like impending VIC. So, what is the, whenever you talk about the treatment of Volkmann systemic contracture, the first thing, the first line in the management, it should be treat the cause, which is acute compartment syndrome. So the first line in the management of Volkmann contracture, ischemic contracture, is early diagnosis and prompt treatment of acute compartment syndrome. So it doesn't go to Volkmann systemic contracture. Once it has gone to Volkmann systemic contracture, no treatment can reverse that pathology. So you have to prevent it from going to that contracture. Now, management of acute compartment syndrome, it is very easy. Don't go by all these things. It is simply fasciotomy. Now, the basic purpose of fasciotomy is to relieve the pressure of those compartment. So in forearm, superficial, volarly, there are two compartments. So you have to do fasciotomy in such a way that both the compartments pressures are relieved. Now, you don't need to go in the details of the fasciotomy, just fasciotomy to ensure that both the compartments of the volar aspects of forearm are relieved from their pressure. Now, that is conservative management of established deformities. These are of little use nowadays. Banjo splint and all, these are visible in old Second World War time. I don't know how many of you have seen that movie. There is one special tank movie, na T-24 or something. In that movie, they were using that. Recently, I saw that splint in that movie. I have never seen these things. Now, as I have told, before the Volkmann systemic contracture sets in, you have to treat the acute compartment syndrome. So the first line of management is early diagnosis and prompt treatment of acute compartment syndrome, which is fasciotomy and release of the pressures of all the compartment that is affected. And before fasciotomy, what you can do, you have to relieve all the external bandage or whatever things are there. You have to just elevate the limbs and all. As soon as the patient comes to you, you release all the external pressure and all. But now we are talking about Volkmann's contracture. Once the contracture has been set in, you cannot reverse it. The deformity, you cannot reverse to a normal functional hand. The only thing you can do with the tendon transfers or some release of the tissue, you can little improve that contracture so that the patient can get a functional limb, not a normal limb. So there are few surgical procedures. You don't have to remember all these names. Just if you have a pen and paper, you just write down what I am saying. So what is the operation you do for Volkmann's ischemic contracture? So the only thing you do, use that. I told you before that all the superficial group of muscles, they arise from your medial epicondyle. So release of the your flexor group of muscles from that common origin, so that all the muscles are tight and it is connected here. So once you release all the muscles from your elbow, it gets relieved, that that tension, that contracture, it gets relieved a bit, because you are detaching the common flexus origins from the proximally. So distally, patient will be able to extend the wrist. And you have to that anteriorly transpose the ulnar nerve also. I think it will be in the next slice. Yeah, that Lacerta's fibrosis also you have to divide. That is why I was emphasizing previously on the slides regarding the anatomy. If you remember, the Lacerta's fibrosis was covering that your nerves, neurovascular structures, as well as common flexor groups. So you have to divide the Lacerta's fibrosis. We have to release that all the muscles from their common flexor origin, and you have to transport the ulnar nerve anteriorly. Now these are two hi-fi things for you people. Only remember one thing: if you are asked to say something regarding the surgery of Volkmann systemic contracture, that is release of the common flexor origins from their origin, which is medial epicondyle, then dividing the Lacerta's fibrosis and transportation of the ulnar nerve anteriorly. That's all.